Good morning. Hope that you guys have had a great week. Can I be warm, but maybe get blown away this week? So that'll be fun. Excited to celebrate Palm Sunday with you guys. As we begin in this time of worship, we're going to sing this celebratory song, The Days of Elijah. And as we sing this song of just thanksgiving and praise, we're looking over the Old Testament and some of the great moments of God working and moving in the people of God and the Israelites. And as we think about that, I just want you to think about as Jesus is coming into Jerusalem is what we celebrate on Palm Sunday. Just think about all of the waiting, all of the culminating, all of the building up to this climactic week of Christ coming to do what he said he was going to do. As he made the promise, even we think about the promise to Adam and Eve that he would restore them, that he would defeat the serpent. As we think about the promise to Abraham, as we think about the promise to renew the kingdom of Israel as it was conquered. And all of those things are culminating to the moment of Christ going that week to Calvary. And let's just think about that wonderful significance that Christ is bringing all of those things to pass. Let's stand as we celebrate this risen and coming King. Again, riding on the clouds, Lord, to come and restore this world. God, as you have restored our hearts, God, as you have made us new through the blood of the Lamb, there is likewise a hope and a promise, God, that you will restore this world. God, and we thank you so much for all that you're doing, all that you continue to do. Let us look to this holy week, God, with thanksgiving, and let it lead us into adoration. In Jesus' name, amen.
So the accordion has hit the stage again. It's always a good Sunday when the accordion hits the stage. So glad you're here this morning. I want to just mention a few things before we pray together this morning. First of all, this is a very, very important week. Today is Palm Sunday, and moving into the Holy Week, this next Sunday we have Easter, and where we celebrate the resurrection of Christ. And we're going to have two services next Sunday morning. They're going to be at 9 and 10:30, and they're going to be at Community Hall just down the road here, 512 6th Avenue. And we have a ton of these invite cards. And aren't these kind of cool, little circular invite cards here? I will give credit where credit is due. Ashton came up with these, so very thankful for him putting these together. But we've got quite a few of these out here on the table in the hallway. So if you want to grab some of these and invite people next week, that would be very, very helpful. We encourage you to do so. But leading into Easter next week, we're also going to do something on Good Friday where we remember the crucifixion of Christ. And we're not going to do a service here at the church building, but we're going to have a 15 or so minute devotional that will be put up on our church's Facebook page and on our church's webpage, BelleFourcheConnection.com. And that'll be up by around 3 o'clock or so Friday, probably a little bit before that. But encourage you to watch that devotional and get together with family or friends or family and friends and pray together and kind of maybe discuss that devotional a bit. So again, just a huge week on the Christian calendar. And I'm very, very excited that this week has arrived. A couple other things. I was out last week. I was in Bismarck, and I had the privilege of worshiping with Hope City Church. They are one of the churches that our church supports financially. They're a brand new church. They started about a year ago. And as you can imagine, trying to plant a church and then all of a sudden the pandemic hitting, that's not the ideal time to plant a church. It's hard to get out and meet people, but they're doing a wonderful job there. There were around probably 30 people in attendance last Sunday morning when I was there, and Chris Wallace is the pastor of Hope City, and Chris, it was very special for me because Chris was in my youth group when I was a youth pastor back in the early 2000s, and so I got to see him come to Christ and surrender to ministry, and now he is doing a wonderful work there, great preacher, a real heart for what they're doing there in Bismarck, and so it was just great to be there, and last Sunday was unique to me. I got to sit and I got to sing songs, and I didn't have to do a thing during that service. I got to worship just as an attender, and it was really, really good for me. It was a bit, I wanted to hop up and help with certain things, but I restrained myself from doing so, but it was just great to be there and to see that church in their early stages. Reminded me so much of early 2014. A lot of you guys were here for that, and just very similar to our church, and so excited about what God is doing there. You guys, many of you know Matt Haddon, who was here last week, but what a wonderful message he gave last week. I'm so grateful for the work that they're doing on Pine Ridge. So it was just great to have him here last week. Back to Bismarck, we're going to be taking a team out there in June to do a little volunteer work there, help them do some things in as they reach out to their community. So that trip is going to be in June. We're going to have a informational meeting about that if you're interested in going. It'll be after our third service today. So you're here early enough to where you can go home after this and eat breakfast and lunch and then come back for that meeting if you'd like to be a part of that team or if you would just like to learn more about that opportunity. A couple other things. Just a reminder to you, we have our North American Mission offering coming up on, I believe it's April 18th, it's the week after Easter, or no, April, yes, April 18th, 2 weeks after Easter. So encourage you to pray about what God would have you give to that. I say this every year, but I don't often talk about money, but twice a year I unashamedly ask you to give sacrificially because for our Christmas missions offering for international missions and then our Easter offering for North American missions, we give that money away, 100% of that we give away to send and support missionaries around the world. So that's going to be on the 18th. Encourage you to pray about what God would have you give. And then one final thing, as many of you know, we have a new pastor coming. He and his family will be arriving here on Thursday, and they'll be here around 1 o'clock is their goal, and we need help. They need help. We need help helping them unload and kind of get unpacked. So if any of you are able to help this Thursday around 1 o'clock, please let me know, and I will get you more information as we have it as to when they'll be here. But excited about that, thankful for the fact that God has called this family to be here with our church and to be able to help in areas where we really do need some help. So that was a lot of announcements, but a lot of things going on, a lot of exciting things. So glad you're here this morning. Let's bow and let's commit this time to God. Father, thank you so much for everyone who is here this morning, God. Thank you for this beautiful day you have given us. And Lord, I just pray that as we think about what this day represents, what this day commemorates, the entry of Jesus into Jerusalem on Passion Week, God, I pray that our hearts would be lifted up to you. Lord, as we open up your word, as we look at John chapter 12 and then Philippians chapter 2 this morning, I pray that you would be exalted, that you would be glorified, that your name would be lifted high, and that we would leave here this morning challenged to walk with you more closely, to love you more deeply. God, everything we do, may it be for your glory this morning, and we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Hope you're ready to continue in praise. Let's stand together as we continue to praise this great King of Kings as he has come to sovereignly save us. Let's sing this together. Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you. That's how we're going to start this song. Let's sing this together. Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you. Let's sing that again. Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you. There's a city that calls me by name. There's a city that calls me by name. Yes, as I run this race, I am cheered by the saints. There's a city that calls me by name. There's a future that runs through my veins. There's a future that runs through my veins. And there's nothing on earth that can stand in the way. There's a future that runs through my veins. Let's sing this together. Hosanna in the highest, lifting him up. That's what was declared as Jesus came in. And as we sing this word, Hosanna, that we will follow Hosanna, that we will seek after his kingdom and after his will. We're singing, Lord, save me now. And with that is a confidence in that word that he has come, that he is saving you, that he is sustaining you. So as we sing this song, everywhere I go with you. There's a confidence in that because he has come already. He has defeated sin and death in your life as you've given him faith, your faith, and you've put your salvation in him. It's already done. It's already won. The battle has been won for the Lord. So let's sing this with confidence that save me now, and we know that you have.
I see the King of glory coming on the clouds with fire.
Go to him. God, we thank you so much for the privilege of being able to sing these songs in confidence, God. We have the privilege of looking back at Calvary, Lord, as we think about all throughout history of mankind, God. Honestly, there's less time, God, since the cross than there was before, and what a privilege it is to look back and see that moment that Jesus came, Lord, as so many people before him didn't know what this King of Kings would look like, what it would truly mean to have this Lord of Lords come and restore Israel, come and restore Jerusalem. And now we know that you came to do it in a much greater, much more powerful way than they ever dreamed, God, as you went as a sacrificial lamb to the cross. God, I pray that we would look forward to that, that we would celebrate that this week with thanksgiving and praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
And special Sunday in churches all over the world. Regardless of denominational affiliation, all true Christ-exalting churches mark today down as a special day. Today is Palm Sunday. And Palm Sunday commemorates an event that happened the Sunday before the resurrection of Jesus. This event occurred around 2,000 years ago in the Israeli city of Jerusalem. This was Jesus's entry into Jerusalem on Passover week, just days before his crucifixion and resurrection. And in the Gospel of John, John, as one of the 12 disciples of Jesus, wrote a firsthand account of that day in Jerusalem. He remembered the event very, very well. I'm sure as he was writing about this account, he could remember the shouts of jubilation as the crowd chanted the name of Jesus. I'm sure he could remember the smiles on the faces of the other disciples as they recognized this special event and as they finally felt vindicated in their allegiance to Jesus. It was a day that was filled with wonder and excitement for the disciples and for many in the crowds that day. But several days later, their wonder would be turned into worry and fear. Their excitement would be thrown into chaos, their joy into extreme sadness and confusion. So what I want to do today is briefly look at the account of Palm Sunday number one, the first Palm Sunday found in John chapter 12, but the majority of the sermon I want to be focused on Philippians chapter 2 as we look to Christ as our example and as our substitute. So if you have your Bible, go ahead and start turning over to John chapter 12. John chapter 12. And as you do, I want to ask you a question this morning. What does it mean to be a Christian? What does it mean to follow Jesus? I think if we were to ask people around the world, we would get a lot of different answers, a lot of different responses to that question, even among many who claim to be a Christian. What does it mean to be a Christian? What is the Christian faith all about? The corrupt and deceptive nature of man has led people throughout history to worship all sorts of people and all sorts of things. There have been and certainly are still people today who blatantly worship the earth. They believe that this world is really all that there is. There are a bunch of people who live with a mindset of planet over people. And really, all it ends up, that's their theology. That is what they worship. They believe in perhaps an atheistic evolutionary view that this world is God and therefore people have less value and should be subservient to the planet. There are religions out there, believe it or not, that worship what they perceive to be alien life forms, and they are longing for that day when the aliens come and take them wherever they're going to take them, supposedly. There are people who worship different people. This has happened all throughout history. They worship people who are simply fallible men and women like you and me. There is a group today, and you're going to think I'm making this up, but there is a group today that worships Prince Philip of the royal family as God. Did you know that? There is an island about 1,000 miles from Australia in the South Pacific who had a belief generations ago that a very powerful God married an earth woman and they had a child together and someday that child would return to their earth. So years ago when this primitive people saw Prince Philip show up unannounced at their island, they just assumed him to be this long-awaited promised child, and they worship him as such today. There is even a religion today called Jediism. Yes, from the movie Star Wars. And they blend Eastern world religions, but at the core of their teaching are the teachings of the Jedis found from the movie Star Wars. How many of you believe that that's legit? You can look it up. That is legit. I know you think there's no way, but it really is. There's a group in India today that worships a motorcycle as their god. The guy that owned it, they believe to be divine, and he crashed on that motorcycle and died, and they now worship that motorcycle. And, you know, we kind of joke and laugh about those things, but really those things are tragic. Those are tragic. If you read the Old Testament, you will find ancient civilizations that worshiped gods such as Baal and Molech and Ashtaroth. Molech was worshipped as God, and part of the ritual of worship to Molech was to sacrifice children to him. Ashtaroth was known as the goddess of sexuality and fertility. And as you can imagine, all sorts of lewd and base and depraved things were done in worship of this pagan goddess. People in the past, people today worship money and material goods. People worship fame and prestige and popularity and power. People worship political ideologies. There are just so many different things that people bow down before, and it is wrong, it is satanic, it is tragic, and it is completely unnecessary. Completely unnecessary. Longing for acceptance, longing for peace, longing for purpose, people bow down to many different things in this world. And from one thing to the next, they find one constant, one constant. They find that those objects of worship can never produce the results that they long for deep within their soul. So they tragically move on from one object of worship to the next, only to find once again sorrow and deeper emptiness and a greater longing for truth. Yet, the Word of God, the Scriptures tell us clearly where we can find truth, where we can find purpose, and where we can find life. So let's briefly look at this first Palm Sunday narrative found in John chapter 12, and then we're going to go over to Philippians chapter 2 in conclusion. Look at John chapter 12. Let's start in verse 9. It says, the large crowd of the Jews then learned that he was there. Now, where is there? This is, at this point, Jesus is in Bethany, a village not far away at all from Jerusalem. You can think of it like a bedroom community of Jerusalem. That's kind of where he was. It's also the village, if you remember back one chapter earlier in chapter 11, it's the village where Mary, Martha, and Lazarus were from. And in chapter 11, we find the account of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. So that is where he is. Look at verse 9. The large crowd of Jews then learned that he was there. And they came, not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might also see Lazarus, whom he raised from the dead. But the chief priests planned to put Lazarus to death also, because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. So in these verses, we see the curiosity of the crowds in this village of Bethany. They wanted to see not only Jesus, but they wanted to see his living, breathing miracle of Lazarus. Look at verse 12. On the next day, the large crowd who had come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took the branches of the palm trees and went out to meet him, and they began to shout, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel. Now, this scene that we just read about here, this would have terrified and it would have angered the religious leaders in Jerusalem to no end. This was their worst fears. The large crowd was bowing down before Jesus, and they were crying out, save us, save us now. And we see not only in John, but in Matthew, Mark, and Luke also, all of the gospel accounts contain the triumphal entry of Christ. And so we can put all of those, harmonize all those together in different details that other authors gave us that John might not have. And we know that not only were they laying down palm branches and waving palm branches, but they were putting their cloaks down as well as Jesus rode over on the donkey. And so they are there before Jesus as he's coming into Jerusalem, and they are worshiping him. They are crying out, save us now. Palm branches were used as symbols of victory to the Jews and among other cultures. And so what they are signifying is that they believe that Jesus just might be the victory that they have been waiting for, the long-awaited Messiah that they have been praying for. Now, why did they believe that? Why did they believe that maybe Jesus was the one they had been waiting for? We'll look down at verses 17 and 18 here. So the people who were with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to testify about him. For this reason also the people went and met him, because they heard that he had performed this sign. So they know what Jesus has done. I mean, they can look at Lazarus, this man who had been in the grave for several days, who is now alive. They saw Jesus as a miracle worker. And Jesus had done remarkable, mysterious miracles in the sight of many people throughout this region. And they thought that if Jesus could do mighty miracles such even to the extent of raising the dead, then maybe, just maybe, he was the one to deliver the Jews from Roman rule that they were currently being oppressed under. And they were right about him being the deliverer, but they had a different idea of what their deliverance should look like. So the crowd, seeing Jesus as a potential conquering hero, they cry out, Hosanna, which means we beseech you, save us now. And by the way, that is a quotation from Psalm 118, verses 25 and 26. So they're quoting Scripture, save us now. Look at verses 14 and 15. Verse 14, Jesus, finding a young donkey, sat on it, as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." Now this is a quotation and a fulfillment of the Old Testament prophet Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. Now I want you to put yourself in the position of the 12 disciples for a moment. In this emotionally charged moment, they had to feel vindication. They had to feel vindication. For around 3 years at this point, they had been mocked and they had been mistreated by the masses for giving up their lives to follow Jesus. This had to feel so, so good. Even so, they didn't fully understand the magnitude of what they were experiencing in the moment. And here's how we know this. Look at verse 16. These things his disciples, now again, remember John, one of the disciples, is writing this. These things his disciples did not understand at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written of him and that he had done these, and that they had done these things to him. So what John is saying is, we didn't understand in this moment the providential hand of God and the prophetic hand of God at work at this time. They didn't understand. What he's saying is they didn't understand this was a fulfillment of the Old Testament passage of Zechariah. But looking back, John says it's so clear to us the magnitude of this moment. Now look at verses 17 and 18 again. So the people who were with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead, they continued to testify about him. For this reason also the people went and met him, because they heard that he had performed this sign. So again, continued amazement and witness of the miracle of raising Lazarus from the dead. Now what is sad is that some of those who were bowing down to Jesus on that day would later turn on him when he didn't fit the mold that they had fashioned him into. Listen to this. Many of those this day, they were bowing down to the power of Christ, the resurrection of Lazarus and the miracles. They were bowing down to the power of Christ, but not the person of Christ. They were seeking Jesus out of sensationalism rather than for salvation. And we've got to be very careful about this as well. We've got to be careful about this. We've got to be careful not to craft Jesus in our minds into something that he is not. It's easy to pick and choose what we desire God to look like, but that is really no, when we do that, that is really no different than crafting an idol and worshiping an idol that we have made in our minds. Because to view God any other way than the way the scriptures reveal him to us is idolatry. It's idolatry. Look at verse 19. So the Pharisees said to one another, "You see that you are doing no good at all. Look, the world has gone after him." So this is just further resolve by the religious leaders to kill Jesus, driven out of fear and driven out of jealousy. Now that is a very brief snapshot of what happened on this first Palm Sunday as Jesus set his mind on the cross by entering into Jerusalem. Now flip over really quickly to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. And this is a beautiful, beautiful passage of Scripture. Philippians chapter 2. And in these verses, we find not only the power and the preeminence of Jesus, but we also encounter the humility and grace of Jesus. And it is there that we find our ultimate example in life to follow. Look at Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Paul writes here, "Therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, if there is any consolation of love, if there is any fellowship in the Spirit, if any affection and compassion, make my joy complete by being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose." How beautiful are those verses, and yet how difficult are they to live out in reality? Unity. I mean, think about these again. Look at verse 2. "Make my joy complete, being of the same mind." It is hard to be of the same mind. Maintaining the same love. Maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Anyone who has been a part of a church for any period of time, you know that it is hard to be unified at times. There may be different philosophies or different opinions about certain things, and it's easy for disunity to drive a wedge in a church or in a marriage or in a parenting relationship, in friendships. Unity is difficult. How is unity possible? Look at verses 3 and 4. "Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others." So Paul writes here that we are to put the needs of others before our own. Now, you and I both know, all of us know, that the inclination to look out for oneself is very natural to us. the inclination to look out for oneself is also the root of all of our problems today in this world. It is, I mean, think about it. It's what ushered sin into this world. In fact, you know, Adam selfishly desiring his own will over God's will ushered in devastation that is being felt even to the present day. Satan desiring his way over God's way resulted in his expulsion from heaven and his spiral of hatred and venom throughout the ages, even to the present. Selfishness hurts others, but ultimately destroys the one who is selfish. Because it is consuming. It is never satisfied. It is always hungry for more. And it is something that is natural within us because of our original earthly father, Adam. Now, some would say, well, you know, I'm just kind of selfish. It's just kind of the way that I am. I can't really help it. And listen, while it is true that we all have selfishness innately within us, we choose to be selfish, right? I mean, it is a choice that we make. It's not something that's out of our control. We choose to be selfish. And Paul wrote, do nothing from selfishness. Make a choice to not live life that way. Notice what Paul writes next here. He says, do nothing from empty conceit. Now, the word for empty conceit is, it's a singular word in the Greek language in which this was written, but it's a compound word. And it's the first part of the word means empty or hollow. And the second part of the word means glory. In fact, I believe the King James Version, the old King James, I think it, does anyone have a King James in here by chance? I think it says vainglory. Does it say vainglory there? I know in some of the older King James translations, it's the word empty conceit translated New American, but in some it says vainglory. And that's empty conceit, empty glory, vainglory. That is the idea. And what he's saying here is ultimately it is an exalted and an unreasonable view of oneself. Now, again, we often joke about those who are arrogant. We say, man, that guy is so arrogant. And we kind of make a joke about it, but listen, When a person has this empty conceit, this elevated view of himself, that will invariably manifest itself in selfishness toward others because in arrogance, our ways and our needs become supreme to the needs of others. And at that point, others become a means to a selfish end. We see others as being a way to get what we want. So this call to reject selfishness, this call to reject this empty conceit is not a call that is easy to obey because the draw to look out for number one is so incredibly natural to us. So this exhortation to reject selfishness and to reject empty conceit requires several things that Paul addresses in these verses. Number one, it requires humility. It requires humility. Look at verse 3 again. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but the other side to that, he says, is with humility of mind. Regard one another as more important than yourselves. It requires to reject this selfishness, to reject this empty conceit. It requires humility. And ultimately, what Paul is writing here is humility of mind is the opposite of empty conceit. Are we going to choose to be humble in mind, or are we going to choose to allow ourselves to be full of empty pride? Well, that ultimately, the answer to that question depends on what we subject ourselves to by putting into our minds. Are we going to put truth into our minds, or are we going to listen to lies and put falsehood into our minds? You see, it is in our mind that we develop opinions of ourselves and others. It is in our mind that we then formulate plans based on our view of God, based on our view of self, and based on our view of others. I've said this many, many times, but our mind is where this battle rages. It is in our mind. And humility of mind is found in the way of Jesus. He is our example. The principles of this world are opposed to the principles of the kingdom of God. Have you noticed that? The things of this world have nothing to do with the things of God. They are diametrically opposed. They are opposites. Which worldview will you adopt? The ways of this world or the ways of Jesus? Well, again, it depends on what we put in our mind. So first of all, humility is required to reject selfishness and empty conceit. Secondly, it requires intentionality. Look at verse 4. Do not merely look out for your own personal interest. Now, let me just stop here and say this. Do not merely look out for your own personal interest. As a husband and as a dad, I'm to care for my family. I'm to provide for my family. Notice it says, don't merely look out for your own personal interest. Take care of others in your life. Take care of things that you need in your life. But what he's saying here is don't let life be all about you. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. Now, again, this requires intentionality. This is a choice that we make. It is a choice to see others, to really see others. I remember when we were, or actually I heard this illustration. I had a friend who was on doing some mission work on the other side of the world in a very impoverished area. And he said that there was a guy walking around at church one day and he had a shirt on. No idea what the shirt was about, but all it said is, "Do you see me?" And he said in that moment he got so convicted, because do we see the impoverished? Do we see the hurt? Do we really see people? I'm not talking about with our physical eyes. I mean, like, do we see their needs? Do we see their groaning? Do we see the love that God has for them? This is to see others, to hear their cry for help. Am I going to choose to intentionally live my life with others in mind? Am I going to look for ways to serve others? Am I going to look for ways to glorify God through emulating Him by serving and loving others? This call to reject selfishness and empty pride requires humility. It requires intentionality. And then number three, it requires an example for us to know and follow. Look at verse 5. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. He is our example. Now, verses 5 through 8, Philippians 2, 5 through 8, I am telling you, are some of the richest, deepest theological treasures in all of the Bible. They really, really are. In fact, many scholars believe that these verses, 5 through 8, were originally sung in churches in worship, that it was a hymn of worship. Just like we would sing Amazing Grace, they would have sung these verses. And these verses, 5 through 8, they are dripping with theological truth and with a practical invitation for us to emulate and imitate the living God. Jesus is the greatest example of humility and selflessness that we will ever find. Now, before we read verses 6 through 8 to see the humility of Christ, I want us to think for a minute about who Jesus is. Because once we dwell on the person of Jesus, it makes it the sacrifice of Christ and the humility of Jesus all the more remarkable. I want you to think with me for a minute about the vastness of God. Everything we observe in the created world, to the immensity and the complexity of our cosmos, is but a speck compared to the vastness of God. Our world, our planet, our galaxy, everything there is in creation, consider this, with a simple word was created by God, revealing to us the enormity of God. Think about His sovereignty. He is Lord over the affairs of all men, from the richest to the poorest, from the greatest to the least. He is the greatest King ever, and yet He is involved in our lives down to our day-to-day interactions and even our momentary thoughts. He rules over all nations. He rules over all presidencies, over all politics, over all wars, over everything. There is nothing that is ever out of His control or out of His understanding. His character is faultless. He has never had a sinfully jealous thought or a lustful thought or a sinfully hateful thought. He has never done anything wrong. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And the wonder of that is He is eternally good. Think of the unparalleled and the unmatched wisdom and knowledge of Christ. There is absolutely nothing that has or can or ever will happen that He does not have a perfect understanding and knowledge of. He knows all things perfectly. He knows all things completely. He knows every pain that is happening on planet Earth right now, every abuse, every wife that is being beaten, every child that is being abused, every abortion, every miscarriage, every divorce, every heartbreak, every burden, every drug addiction, every fear, every worry that you and I carry in our hearts right now. He sees those things and He cares more than anyone else. Ponder His truthfulness for a moment. The Scriptures tell us that God cannot lie and He hates lies. He always does what His Word says He will do. He always keeps His promises, and we can trust Him. Think of His grace, like the old hymn, grace, grace, God's grace, grace that can pardon and make us whole. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all of our sins. Over and over, We have broken God's commandments. We have hurt other people who are made in the very image of God. We have taken advantage of God's forbearance and his patience. Yet God, in his grace, causes the rains to fall on this old earth. He causes the sun to rise every day. He provides food for us to eat, water to drink, air to breathe. He gives us family. He gives us friends because he is, as James wrote, he is the giver of all good things. That's who our God is. Dwell on the wonder of his love. The world around us is rapidly and ever changing. Cultures change. Peoples change. Life's circumstances change, but God's love remains constantly perfect. He loves us with a love that is unequal and unchanging. There is nothing that we can do today to make him love us more than he does right now, and there's nothing we can do that will make him love us any less. Think about the purpose that he imparts to our lives. We were made for a relationship with him, made by him and made for him. And when we begin to become passionate for Jesus, we then begin to understand what Jesus meant when he offers us, when he said he offers us life and life abundant. He is not talking about abundant life by us acquiring all the pleasures that this world can offer. He is talking about abundancy by us knowing him and loving him and treasuring him above everything else. Think about the eternal nature of our God. Psalm chapter 90 verse 2 says, before the mountains were born, or before you gave birth to the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Let these truths motivate you. Let them enrich and enliven your soul. There are a lot of people out there that have a very small view of God. They put man as supreme and God down here, but my friends, have a big, big view of God because that's who he is. But understand this, here's the crazy part about this. Even in all of those descriptions about God that we just went through, we affirm what Job said in Job 26:14 when he stated, behold, these are but the fringes of his ways. We look around at creation and we say, God, you are so big, and God did create and God is big. But we look around at creation and we begin to equate that with God. But my friends, everything we see, everything we just talked about, those are but the fringes of who God is. For all eternity, we're going to be learning more about who he is. Now, with that view of God in mind, look back at Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 through 8. Look at verses 6 and 7. Here's what it says. It says, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men. Consider the humility of Christ. God, in the form of man, yet willingly shrouded in humility. Jesus, the Son of God from all eternity, chose to empty himself and put on flesh. Now remember the call that we looked at back in verse 3 to avoid empty conceit. How do we avoid empty conceit? It's by emptying ourselves, right? By emptying ourselves. And it says here that Jesus emptied himself. He took the form of a bondservant. Jesus didn't come into the world with great pomp and circumstance. He didn't come into the world with great fanfare. He wasn't born in an earthly family of great wealth or influence. He was born of a common family, and we know that he was even born in a stable. He walked on this same old earth as you and I. He didn't come in the garments of a king. He came clothed in the garments of a servant, garments of humility. Now look at verse 8. Verse 8 says, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. This is ultimate humility. Ultimate humility, wrongly charged, died willingly for those who actually deserved that sinner's death. Now, if Jesus came into this world and lived in humility, why would we suppose as Christians that we don't have to live that way? Why would we think Jesus came in humility, but I don't have to live life that way? Listen to this. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, Jesus, the Son of God, washed the dirty feet of his disciples. And after doing so, in John 13, verses 14 through 17, Jesus said this to his disciples, if I then, the Lord and teacher, washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I gave you an example that you should do as I did. Truly, truly, listen to this. Truly, truly, I say to you, a slave is not greater than his master. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. See, the call to empty ourselves is ultimately the call to follow Jesus. They're one and the same. The call to empty ourselves is the call to imitate Christ. Look at verse 9. Verse 9, it says, "For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name." So we see the preeminence and the exaltation of Christ, given a name that is above every name. That's why Acts chapter 4, verse 12, we read, "There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved." Look at verse 10. "So that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth." The scriptures tell us plainly here, every knee will bow before Jesus, but the question is when. The question is when. It's not a question of if, it is a question of when you are going to bow. Everyone who has ever lived, everyone who lives now, everyone who will live, there is coming a day where every single person, whether willingly, whether in this life they choose to follow Jesus and bow their knee before him in worship, but everyone is going to bow before him someday. Everyone is going to bow their knee, from Adolf Hitler to the most crazy, the most demonic people throughout human history. All of them are not going to have a choice. Someday they are going to bow and say, "Jesus, you are Lord." But when we do that affects everything about our eternity. Will you do it in this life? Will you bow before Christ and follow him, or will it be forced in the next life? And I'm telling you, you don't want that. You don't want that. Every knee will bow. Not only that, look at verse 11. "And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." Everyone's going to confess him as Lord. Everyone's going to bow their knee. Everyone is going to confess. Again, the question is when. Now, back to this first Palm Sunday, back to the beginning of this message, there were undoubtedly people in the crowd that first Palm Sunday who bowed down before Jesus, yet they had zero allegiance to Jesus. Once Jesus did not fit their mold, their allegiance was shown to be but a veneer of religion and selfishness rather than a desire for relationship. You see, the call to being a Christ follower is not just a call to morality and good deeds. It isn't just a call to try to make God happy so he will bless you and do your bidding. It is a call to live life like Jesus. It is a call to lordship. It is a call to bow your knee to Christ and really mean it. It is a call to confess him as Lord no matter the cost. It is the call to love others. It is the call to lay down our desires, trusting that God's desire for us is better. It is the call to suffer if necessary for the cause of our Lord. And here's how Jesus said it, one of the most clear passages in the Bible. Luke 9:23, Jesus said, "If anyone wishes to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me." That is the call of Christianity. And so I ask you, do you tip your cap to Jesus, or are you a disciple of Jesus? There are a lot of cultural Christians today, especially where I grew up. I grew up in the buckle of the Bible Belt South. And I've seen this firsthand. And here's the problem I see at work in a lot of lives of so many who identify with the Christian faith, especially in our country, is that we say that our lives are bowed down to Jesus, but when our lives are examined, there's very little to no evidence there. If someone were to have full access to my life and yours right now, both public and private, those things that nobody else knows about, would they find enough evidence to conclude that Jesus is the Lord of our lives? Would our claims of love and allegiance to Jesus be substantiated, or would they be found false? Unfortunately, I really believe there are many who would, in their deception, say, "Well, I believe there's evidence there." And their reasoning would go something like this: "I go to church. I'm there, you know, two or three times a month. I try to be a good person. I try to provide for my family. I try to do good things more often than I do bad things." You know, you have a dad who would say something like, "You know I don't really lead my family all that great, but I provide for them." So do possums, by the way. That's not our standard, right? I mean, there's animals that provide for their families as well. That's not our standard. But there's a lot of people who would make all of these great claims about, you know, just their religiosity, their morality. But going to church on Sunday morning, this isn't enough. It's good, and we need to be here. We're commanded to be here. Trying to just keep a set of moral rules is not enough. Again, it's good to be moral. Trying to keep up a certain spiritual image and persona is not the goal. The goal is that we be conformed to the likeness of Christ. The goal is that we completely surrender to the one who gave everything, the one who gave himself to liberate us from our spiritual chains. Are you a cultural quote-unquote Christian, or do you follow and imitate Christ? I was playing baseball. I played a lot of baseball when I was a kid, and I remember when I was probably, I'm guessing probably 9 or 10 years old, it was before a game, and one of my friends was up there, and he was warming up and just swinging his bat, you know, around and kind of getting ready. And another friend of mine named Jordan, you met people like this before who were just a walking accident ready to happen at any moment. This was Jordan. And Jordan just comes walking up, and he's got some sunflower seeds. He's not paying a bit of attention, and he walks right behind my friend as he's swinging. And so on his follow-through, he just clips Jordan right in the, right above the eye. And Jordan just hits. Look, it's fine now. He's no long-term damage or anything, so I can laugh about it now. Jordan hit the ground like a bag of, you know, like a sack of potatoes, and he's got this blood streaming out of his forehead. And I vividly remember as a 9 or 10-year-old boy, Jordan kind of got up, and he kind of was, you know, kind of falling around, and he was trying to talk, and his words weren't really coming out right. And why was Jordan so messed up? Well, it's clear. He got hit in the head by a aluminum baseball bat, right? And because that happened to him, he walked differently for a bit. He talked differently for a bit. And I just want to encourage you with something. When you have experienced something of the magnitude of the love and the grace and the mercy of God, it will affect you. It has to. It's going to affect the way you talk. It's going to affect the way you walk. It's going to affect the way that you live. Jesus demands our full allegiance. Have you bowed your life before him truly? Or is religion just another compartment of your life? Will you align your life with his will for you? Will you invite him to be the Lord, the master, and the boss of your life? Or will you be like many in this crowd that first Sunday, that first Palm Sunday, bowing down, looking good, looking religious, but with no intention of following Jesus? What does it mean to be a Christian? It means that we know God. It means that we love God. It means we strive to be like him. He is our example. And because we have experienced his love and his grace, we want to be like him. We want to obey him. We want to please him. Jesus went into Jerusalem that first Palm Sunday knowing what awaited him only a few days later, a torturous death on a cross. And he did so to redeem us from our sin. But he also did this as an example for us to follow. Will you follow the example of Jesus by dying to self? Let's bow our heads right now and close our eyes. Father, right now, we thank you for your word. It is a lamp to our feet, a light to our path. And God, this morning, I pray that we will leave here challenged. I pray that we will leave here thinking deeply about our relationship with you. God, all of us, Lord, help us to truly know you, to truly love you, to give our lives to you, to make you the Lord of our lives, the boss of our lives, God, that we will intentionally choose to live our lives bowed down before you, confessing you as Lord, no matter the cost. And we pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. If you need to talk about any of this, I'd love to hang around and talk with you, or I'd love to set up a time to talk with you. But as we walk into this Passion Week, I pray that we will all be very mindful of our relationship with God, and we will dwell on that and think through it. I'm going to ask you guys to go ahead and stand, and we're going to sing a final song before we leave. Glad you're here this morning.
I come into thy freedom, badness.
Have a great week.